Lord's Supper. Today we also have our fellowship, and today we also have a special guest who's going to be preaching this morning. He's preaching in another church right now, but he's going to come back. But we know him as Joshua, right? That's my son-in-law. Joshua will be preaching today. Amen. The Lord has called them to maybe in that direction. Give the answers. Amen. It's good to be here at the house of the Lord. Welcome, everybody. You happy to be here?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Praise God. My mom hasn't been here in 3 weeks.
Yes.
She's here. So she's the loudest cheerleader. For today, my brother's here today, Robert and his wife, Amy, and his son Josh. It was Josh's birthday yesterday, I believe, right? It was yesterday, so God bless you. Amen. Happy birthday. Amen. We're going to get started with our opening scripture. Brother Joaquin, would you please lead us? Would everybody please stand up, and if you want to use your Bible, it's on Psalms 118, 1 through 8. Psalms 118, 1 through 8. This is God's word. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let the house of Aaron say, his love endures forever. 4.
Let those who fear the Lord say, his love endures forever.
5. When hard pressed, I cried to the Lord. He brought me into a spacious place. 6.
The Lord is with me, and I am not afraid. What can mere mortals do to me?
7. The Lord is with me. He is my helper. I look in triumph on my enemies. Altogether on 8.
It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in humans.
God bless you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Get ready, get ready, get ready for a blessing today in the name of Jesus. The scripture says it is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in men. And we know that as we come into the house of God, no weapon formed against us shall prosper. It doesn't say that there wouldn't be a weapon formed. It says that there would be no weapon that would prosper. That means when the enemies come against us, God takes up the helm. Amen? That means he takes our cover. That means he goes before us. He comes behind us. He guards us in all our ways. He keeps us in all our ways. He leads us beside still waters. Amen? The Bible says in Psalm 23 that he sets a table before me in the presence of my enemies. What does that mean? That means that we're good to go, right? We can sit down and I can eat my sandwich and eat my chips and drink my soda in calm and peace while my enemies are going crazy around me, but I got peace in the name of the Lord Jesus. Amen? That means that I can sit and I'm good to go because Jesus is my cover. We believe and trust in the powerful, mighty blood of Jesus. That is what has saved us. That is what has redeemed us. That is what covers us. That is what gives us power and peace. That is what breaks the chains of the enemy off of our lives, the blood of Jesus. Amen?
Yes.
So as we come together this morning, we come together rejoicing that we have been called. We are the ecclesia. We are the church. Turn to your neighbor and tell him, you're the church. Amen? It's not the building. It's not the building. It's you. You are the one that has been called out of darkness into his marvelous light. Amen? You are the one that has been translated from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his marvelous son, Jesus Christ. Isn't that good news? Come on, no matter what you're going through today, you can trust in the Lord God Almighty. There's nothing he can't do. There's nothing he can't take care of. There's nothing that he can't break off of your life. There's nothing that he can't do for your family members, your wife, your children, your grandchildren. He leads them all in a way that is going to point their feet to his path. Amen? That's what we trust in. The Bible says that if you've been saved, Everyone in your household is going to be saved. Amen. You can find that in the book of Acts. It says, you and your household shall be saved. It doesn't matter what the situation looks like right now. If you're a blood-bought, born-again believer of Jesus Christ, come on, somebody. Your family's going to get saved. You may not see it today, but it's coming. Turn to your neighbor and tell them it's coming. Amen. So let's just take a moment right now and just greet somebody in the name of the Lord Jesus. Tell them God bless you for being here. Say good morning. We're glad that you're here. We're glad that God woke us up this morning and gave us strength. Come on, to dress ourselves, to come into the house of God, to lead us into this place. In Jesus' name, we come rejoicing, Lord. The Bible says to come into his courts with thanksgiving and to come into his presence rejoicing. Amen? And that's what we're going to do this morning. So as we come together this morning to pray, we're going to pray united. We're going to pray in unison. We're going to pray in one accord. And everybody's going to lift their voice today. Amen? And we're all going to pray. If you want to come to the altar, the presence of the Lord is at the altar, folks. This is where he is. The Bible says where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am in the midst of them. Amen. That means that the glory of God is in this place. His power, his presence, his love, his mercy, his goodness, his might, his power. Come on, somebody. So if you want to come to the altar this morning, the Bible says that we should continually be praying, that we should always pray, and never cease to pray. That we should never stop praying, never stop believing, never stop trusting, no matter what our situation looks like. So as we come to the altar and we bow our heads and we humble our hearts, we humble ourselves before the mighty power and the presence of the Lord Jesus. Lord, we come before you, God, this morning. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for being in this place, Lord. You are mighty. You are wonderful, Lord. We come to worship and exalt your mighty name. We come to magnify the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We come to lift up one name to exalt you above all. You are Hosanna. Come save us now, Lord God. You are the mighty power. You are El Gibor. You are the mighty one of Israel. You are the God of a thousand cattle and all the hills and all the earth is yours, Lord, and everything in it. Lord, we just lift up your name, Lord. You are majestic. You are the King of kings and the Lord of lords. You are the mighty one. You are the Holy One of Israel. You are the one that guards Israel and watches over Israel. And we bless Israel right now in the name of Jesus, Yeshua Mashiach, the one that came to his own, Father, but the own received him not. And Lord, that's why we have the opportunity as Gentiles to be grafted in to your kingdom, Lord God. We thank you, Lord, that you're here. We thank you, Lord, that whatever situation our children are going through, Father, we put them in your hands right now, Lord. We put every situation, every dark situation, every situation that looks like there is no end, Father, we thank you that your light, your power, your glory, and your goodness already has your hand on it, Father. Before we even began to pray, you already knew what our needs were, Lord God. And Lord, right now we choose to focus on your kingdom according to your word in Matthew 6:33, that we would seek the kingdom first and all of its righteousness, and all these things would be added unto us, Lord. Every financial situation, Lord God, you said you would add to it. Every burden of the household, you said you would add to it, Lord. Every situation in our family that may be looking strange, Father, you said that you would add to it. You said, Lord, that you would make every crooked way straight. You said, Lord, that you would hold us and guard us in your hand. You said, Lord, that we are in your hand. You've written our names in the palm of your hand, and no man would remove it, Father. We trust that, Lord. Some trust in chariots and some trust in horses. Lord, we trust in the name that is above all names, the name of Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, the magnified one, the majestic one, the royal one, the blessed one, the one whom is the kingdom and the power and the honor and the glory and the power, Lord God. It's all for you, Lord. It's all yours, Lord. We come and we humble ourselves in your mighty presence, Lord God. We thank you, Lord, that whatever situation, some enemy of ours, some hater of ours, somebody that's trying to come against us, Lord God, we pray that right now you would raise up a standard right there in that place, Father God, and bring that thing down to nothing, Lord God. We pray, Lord, that just like you brought the walls of Jericho down, Lord God, that you would break down every stronghold in the name of Jesus. Your word says, Lord, that our warfare is not carnal, Father, but is mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, Lord. Lord, your word says, Lord, that your name is a refuge. Your name is a strong tower. Your name is strength. Your name is power, Lord God. And as we speak the name of Jesus this morning, Lord God, you're doing everything in your power that you can to make everything good. Your word says that you would turn around every situation for our good because we are called by your name and we love you, Jesus. We love you this morning, Lord God. We love you because you watch over us. We love you, Lord God, because you've saved us, Lord God. We can't save ourselves, Lord. It's by grace. It's not of our own works, lest we should boast, Lord God. But it is your precious gift that you have saved us, that you have called us, that you have redeemed us, Lord God. Lord, we come to your altar this morning, God, because we want to reach out, Lord. We want to intercede for families, Lord God. We want to intercede for our neighbors, Lord God, that they would come to know the truth by our actions, by our words, by our deeds, Lord God. Lord, we pray that you would give us the strength and the means and the supply, Lord God, to be your hands and feet to this neighborhood and to all the neighborhoods around, every neighborhood that we live in, Lord God. And Lord, we beseech thee now, Lord, send prosperity, Father. Send prosperity here to this place, Lord, at West Lawn Baptist, Lord, so that we can distribute your gifts and your word and your kingdom and your provision, Lord God. You are Jehovah Jireh, our provider, Lord God. And we trust that you're going to provide. Father, we trust that you are able to do exceeding abundantly above anything we could think or ask according to the power that's at work within us, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, that the same spirit that raised up Jesus from the dead is alive in us now, God, and strengthening us in our mortal being, Father God. Though the outside would perish, I'm being renewed each and every day in my inner man, Lord. I thank you for it, Father. Lord, we come together this morning, touching together every situation, Lord, those things that our tears can only say, Father, those things that only our hurt and our heart can say, Lord. And we thank you, Lord, that you can understand even our deepest groanings, Father, and that those things that we don't even know how to pray, it's by your spirit that we're able to say those things, even through groaning, Father, even through crying, Father, even through our situation, Lord God, even through the darkness, Lord God, you're able to lift us up in every situation, Lord. We thank you, Father, this morning for your mighty presence, Lord. We thank you, Lord God, that you're already doing everything that we need, Lord God. That we don't have to do anything, that your word says that we should not be anxious and worry for anything, but in every situation through prayer and supplication, make our requests known to you, Lord, and that your peace that passes all understanding would guard our minds and our hearts through Christ Jesus, our Lord. And Lord, that we ask that you keep our mind stayed on you, because your word declares that when we keep our mind perfectly positioned on you, your peace, your perfect peace comes on our life, Lord God. And that's what we need this morning, God. We need your peace. We need your spirit this morning. Holy Spirit, we ask that you come into this place in a mighty way. Touch every heart, touch every mind, change every life today, that we would never be the same when we walk out of here today, that our ears would hear what the Spirit has to say today in the name of Jesus, that we would be lifted up and built up and put in a high place the way you've called us to be, Lord God. And Lord, we just thank you, God, for everything that you're doing, everything you've already done, everything you're going to do, those things that you already have preordained, pre-planned, pre-done. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. And if you believe that, clap your hands and give him the praise this morning. Amen. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I need some microphone up here. We're going to give Lord all the praise. We're going to praise Jesus this morning. We're going to exalt his holy name. We're going to remind ourselves through song and through prayer that he is the mighty one. Amen. That there's nothing he can't do. And as we sing these songs, you know, I only try to pick songs that will exalt the name of Jesus, not any man. We're not singing about songs about us. We're not singing about the good things that we get out of life. We're singing about Jesus. We're going to give him praise. We're going to give him glory. We're going to give him all the magnification. We're going to make God big in this place, and we're going to make ourselves small. The scripture says that that he would be exalted and that I would be made low. Amen. That he would increase so that I can decrease. Amen. Our life is hidden in Christ. Galatians 2:20 says that I am crucified with Christ. It's no longer I that live, but Christ that lives in me. And though I live my life in this flesh, I don't put any confidence in this flesh, but I put my confidence in the one who gave himself and loved me and died for me. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Because Jesus Christ is our living hope. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Come on, he is your living hope as we live and breathe today.
Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. Savior, I'm yours forever, Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Hallelujah!
That has lost its grip on me. You
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for all that you've done. All that you've done and all that you're going to do. We give you praise this morning for your amazing grace. The Bible says, clap your hands, O ye people, and make a joyful noise. You don't got to sing perfect. I know I don't, but I'm going to lift my voice anyway. I watch a lot of videos about music. I watch a lot of praise and worship. Because what else do we have to do but give him honor and glory every single day? And you know, I was seeing this guy the other day, and he said it so simply, is that we sing these songs, right? But do we believe what we're singing? Do we really believe what we believe? Amen. And this song in particular was a blessing when I heard it this way, is that it says that water he turned into wine. He opened the eyes of the blind. There's no one like him. Amen. Into the darkness he shines. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like him. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Awesome in power. Our God, and here it is right here. If our God is with us, then who could ever stop us? If our God is with us, then what can stand against us? If our God is for us, turn to your neighbor and say, my God is for me. If he's for me, then who can be against me? Amen. So when we sing this song, we lift our hearts. We got to believe that what we're saying is really real. It's really true. He is greater than any other God that there is. And there is no other God like him. Amen. Y'all got to help me keep the beat, right? Awesome in power, our God. Nothing can come against the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Nothing can come against the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We're going to pick up our offering. Hallelujah. You can stay standing. We're going to do something a little different today. We're going to do the offering, of course. And blessed be the name of the Lord Jesus, who receives every offering, everything that you can give him. The Bible says that he loves a cheerful giver. Amen. That means that we don't give begrudgingly. We don't give because we think we have to. We give because we want to. And because we're believers, we keep our hands open so that God can fill it and take and give and take and give, because that's what he does. He takes away and then he gives, and then he gives and then he takes away. But it's all for his glory and it's all for his name. So, Lord, we lift up this offering this morning. And we ask, Lord, that you would multiply everything that comes into this storehouse, Lord God, and that you would give the leadership here wisdom to distribute it. Every dollar, every dime, every quarter, every nickel, stretch it to its max. You're able to do exceeding abundantly above anything that we could ask. You are our giver, God. You are Jehovah Jireh, our supply, our giver, and the one who provides for us. You are the provision that we need. In Jesus' name, amen. So as we're picking up the offering, I'm going to invite Brother Rocky up. We're going to do a song together. This is a new believer in Jesus. He just recently gave his life to Jesus. Yeah, let's give the Lord all the glory. He recently gave his life to Jesus and immediately felt a call to give God his whole life in worship and praise. And so we pray for his hands and his feet right now, his mind, that he would give it all to Jesus right now. And we're going to share a song together. And as you can see, he's going to be playing the drums. So, you know, this is a testimony right here that God can call anybody. And he will call anybody. And he will bring them out of the midst of us and put them right up here to exalt his name and to show his glory. Amen? Because this is not something that any man could do, right? I probably couldn't have convinced this brother to come off the street, but God drew him in. Amen? The Bible says that when we lift up the name of the Lord Jesus, I will draw all men unto myself. And so God put out a calling, and he called this young man out of whatever he was going through, out of whatever darkness he was in, out of whatever he was going through, right? And God said, I got a plan for your life. Amen? Don't make me cry. I got a plan for your life. So we're going to do this song, and we're going to lift up the name of the Lord. This song is Holy is the Lord. So do you want to put the words up there?
Together.
putting it in the kingdom work. Amen. The Bible says that the harvest is ready, but the laborers are few. So, Lord, we just ask that you send more laborers, whether it be preachers, deacons, ushers, helpers, co-laborers in Christ, and more musicians to lift up your holy name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Those, we're going to be having our Lord's Supper. Those participating in the Lord's Supper may remain standing. Remember, in the Lord's Supper, we believe in believer's baptism. If you have received the Lord Jesus Christ into your heart and have been baptized, please join us in communion.
Yes, Lord.
All my
every breath that I have made, well, I will sing of the goodness of God. Come on, sing with me. All my life, I will sing.
Took bread, and when he gave, had given thanks, he broke it and said,
"And your mercy endures forever.
This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us partake of the bread. And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes."
Amen. Amen.
Let us partake of the new covenant. Amen. You may be seated.
Everybody, at this time, we're going to have Brother Josh. He's going to come up to the front, and he's going to lead the message. Okay, this is my son-in-law, Brother Josh. Now, he used to be here. He used to come here for quite a while. They moved down to the valley, and so that's where they're at, and they're visiting over here. So this is my son-in-law, Josh, and he just got through this morning preaching at another church this morning before coming over here. So
hallelujah.
So praise the Lord.
Thank you. Is this on already? Do I have to turn this on?
In the back.
On now. There we go. Okay. I don't do well with wireless mics. I grew up mostly Baptist, and so the sweet spot for me is right here. I don't do a lot of moving around. It's not for me. Also, forgive my attire this morning. The late senior pastor, Robert, and I'm sure my grandfather would have sent me home before standing up here dressed this way. Forgive me. We were only supposed to be here for 2 weeks, so you get a laid-back speaker this morning, but I promise we will have you out of here in time to meet the other Baptists at lunch. All right. We're going to jump right in. We are going to be in the book of Colossians, chapter 3, verses 8 through 13. Going to read, if you would stand if you are able to, as we read the word of the Lord, where the Lord reads like this: "But now you must put them all away: anger, wrath, malice, slander, and obscene talk from your mouth.
Come on.
Do not lie to one another, seeing that you have put off the old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge after the image of its creator. Here there is no Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, free, but Christ is all and in all. Put on then as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another. And if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other, as the Lord has forgiven you, so you must forgive. You may be seated. If you look here in verse 12, to put on these things, right? It is referring to this overarching statement at the end of verse 11, that Christ is all and in all. And if that is true, which it most certainly is, and if we are to reflect that Christ is all in regards to our hearts, we must put on these things. See, these virtues are very much fitting to Christ being all and in all. And that's the point here. Because Christ is all, then we are to adorn ourselves with humility, meekness, kindness, and patience. And so, what is not being said is that we are not to pay lip service to God. We are not just supposed to be talking, right? We it's not enough to just talk the talk, right? It's easy for us, right? We're talking about being right new Christians, right? Our brother. And what that's like, it's easy very much to say that Christ is all. It's easy for us to talk about religion. It's easy for us to wear it on a shirt. Not that there's anything wrong with those things inherently, but the fact of the matter is that because there is this truth of who Christ is and Him being all, then it's not enough to just be proclaiming it. There are these things that must be happening in us and through us. See, Paul's interest here is getting past something deeper than what we say. It's deeper than wearing it. And what is happening is that Paul is telling us that God is after what's inside. And it's not just being religious. You know, I don't know about you, but growing up as a Christian, I would meet other Christians, and that word Christian, had a lot of weight to it. Right? If I was a Christian and so were you, there was this immediate bond. Right? There was the sharing of these fruits that we would bear. Right? It's almost as if we found a long lost brother or sister. And as time went on, it was almost cool, if you will, to be wearing a "What Would Jesus Do" bracelet. Everybody was wearing it, right? Jesus freak everywhere, right? And all of a sudden, everybody was a Christian. And for me, it was hard because even now, if someone were to say to me that they were a Christian, it doesn't hold the same kind of weight that it did back then. See, it's not enough just to call ourselves something. There is this expectation that is put on us that looks like action. And so what God is after is that this truth of Christ being all, there has to be something happening inside. Because we can look very much like the Pharisees did, who could quote scripture left and right, who could pray the best prayers you've ever heard. And yet when it came to showing people compassion, when it came to reaching out to those in need, it was almost non-existent. Enough to the point where Jesus would say, "They honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me." And we have to consider, is that where we are? We don't want that. We don't want to sound like we're spiritual and yet be completely far from who God is and who he would have us to be. Again, God is not after our lip service. He's very much interested in truth producing something in us. Verse 12 talks about compassion, kindness, and humility, meekness, and patience. And if you remember that we read in verse 8 about anger and this malice that we're supposed to be taking off and putting away. These are direct opposites of each other. And it's this language, right? There are these things that will separate you, brothers and sisters. And then there are these things that will unite you to one another. And so we have these five put-aways, and we have this list of things that we are to put on. He further highlights that these are complete opposites. And that we are to put on the new self. Because if we think about it for a little bit, if we are honest, right, if we consider that if the world demonstrated these five put-ons, right, patience, meekness, humility, kindness, if the world really looked like that, the world would look completely different than it does today. Right? Have you, and just for instance, if you've ever dared to drive the speed limit in a construction zone, you'll quickly find out what this world is full of, right? Road rage, right? The impatience. And we've all been, I don't know if you've ever tried to drive the speed limit. A lot of people honk it, right? We realize what this world looks like. And it's full of anger, it's full of malice. But we've also been those people driving behind those who have dared to drive the speed limit. And what comes out of us? Does it look more like these putaways? Does it look like this anger, this malice? Or does it look like verse 12? Meekness, humility, patience. You see, if you've ever had the experience talking about the gospel to someone who is just not wanting to hear it, or if you've even dared to speak to someone about politics, right, with opposing views, you will quickly find out what this world looks like, right? Sometimes you might even see yourself transform into something that doesn't even look human. We turn into these rabid people, right? Where we're biting at the throats of people who would dare to have opposing ideals. And so, again, what is happening is that Paul is addressing that there are these things that you are not to be like. These old selves. That when we come to Christ, if we belong to Christ, there are these things that you just don't do anymore. And instead, you replace them by putting on your new self and doing these things. And as we read what verse 12 sounds like, right? To have a compassionate heart, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Well, what do we think of when we think of these things? If your answer is Jesus, you would be correct. Jesus is the only one who exemplifies. If we put it down, right, wrote it down, Christ is all of these things. Right, this God-man who puts on, right, this human nature, and yet is showing us what we are all to be like. These are these virtues that we should have, right? If our goal and if our aim is that we proclaim Christ, that he is all and in all, then it's not just enough to say these things. They have to be backed up by these virtues that Christ himself exemplified. And so this is where, right, I ask the question. If I were to ask you to be honest with yourself, who here exudes, like who here is the example of perfect patience here? By being a parent, I quickly learned how impatient I was, right? Or who here is the epitome of kindness? That when someone cuts you off in traffic, you're like, God bless you, brother. No, the reality is, we're not. Our first instinct is always, right, wrath. It always is. And so, as we read through these verses, we should come away from it realizing, man, I'm just this terrible person. Like, one of the things that should be happening as we read through Scripture, as we hear the words of God through those He appointed to write to us, as we go deeper and as we grow, we should see that there is this turning in our hearts. That there is this realization that we are not who we want to be. And so as Paul is presenting this, he's saying that these are the fundamentals of Christian living. Like these are the things that you build on as a Christian. And so when we look through it, we might even feel condemned a little bit. Because if we're honest with ourselves, do we look more like those in verse 8? Or do we look more like verse 12? And for us, if we call ourselves children of God, these aren't options. I want you to hear that when we read this, it's a command that we are to take off something and put on something better. And so it's not a list of gifts that are given to some Christians and not others. See, when God gives Himself to you, right? He doesn't give you just part of Himself. He doesn't do that. He doesn't say, this group of people is going to have these parts of me and these people are going to have this part of me. No, when God is in you, right? When Christ is in you, there is something that should be flowing out of you, and it should be these things. And so I know there's this language of Christ being in us and working through us or putting this on. And there's a lot of just this language, and what I want to just clear up is, because I quickly get confused about, right, this language. Well, how does this work? Is it already in me? Is it something that I have to put on? Is it something that should just be coming out of me? But again, like I said, this is not something we get to pick and choose, brothers and sisters. My son, I don't think he's in here, but my son loves fruits. It's his thing. Breakfast, lunch, and dinner. He can eat it any time of day, right? If we're at a party or if we're at a get-together, he's after one food in particular. It's strawberries. Strawberries is his favorite, right? But if he sees like a grape, or if he sees blueberries, he's like, okay, I'll have some of these. And what I recently found out, going to HEB yesterday, they had fruit cups. And they handed one to me, and he goes, Daddy, can I have it? And I'm like, yes, you can have it. And I give it to him. And he's just there sitting with it, and he doesn't touch it. And then as we're going through the grocery store, and by the time we're leaving, he still hasn't touched it. And I quickly found out that he does not like cantaloupe, right? He doesn't like honeydews. He just won't eat it. Like, he put it in his mouth, spit it out. Like, there's just this inclination that he has towards strawberries, blueberries, and grapes. And when it comes to these melons, right, honeydew and cantaloupe, he's just like, I don't want that. Like, I like fruit, but not that fruit. See, what I'm talking about is, there are these things we put on, and we can't be like, oh, well, you know what? I can try to be kind. And you know what? Maybe I'll work on my patience. And maybe I'll work on, you know, just having a compassionate heart. But we don't get to do that. Do you follow? Like we don't get to pick and choose which ones we're going to put on. This is a command that you're going to put these on. If you believe that Christ is all and in all, then these are the things that you have to exude. These are the things that should just be happening and coming out of you. And as we consider putting these things on, we have to wonder, we have to ask ourselves, how do we get there? What is our drive? What benefits do we get by doing these things? And like I said, as we read through Scripture, we quickly find out just how terrible of a people we are. And there's something that Paul does in the first 11 chapters of Romans. He does something that is just so profound, and it's just this doctrine of depravity. That there is this innate desire for us not to want God, not to want the things that are most lovely. So how do we get to where we put on these things that we have to do? I don't know if you've seen the Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. It starts off with, not immediately, but what really kicks off the story is this young girl named Lucy, right? She finds herself in a wardrobe, and as she goes further and further, she soon finds herself in this whole other world where things are not like the place that she came from. And that should be the thing with us. Christ is that wardrobe. It is only through Christ that we are able to even achieve or even consider doing these things. So how do we get there? If you would actually follow me, we are going to be in Romans chapter 3, verse 19 and 20. So, like I said, Christ is this gateway. Christ is the way that we are going to be able to do these things, and how we get there is something that we are going to walk through together, as Paul writes. He says in Romans chapter 3, verse 19 and 20, "Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be stopped, and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For by works of the law, no human being will be justified in his sight, since through the law comes knowledge of sin." We're all condemned. We're all guilty. That's it. Romans 3 starts out as telling us that we're in trouble, a big trouble. But as we read, we will soon find this pattern. Romans chapter 3, verse 21 and 22. "But now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it. The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. There is no distinction." And as we read deeper in verse 23 and 25, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith." So if you're starting to see this pattern, it is this pattern of undeserving, and then we are met with this mercy. Right? In verse 12, we would be reading in the King James, it's worded bowels of mercy. Right? And that might sound kind of weird, right? We don't use bowels in a good connotation, really. But the way the wording is in King James is is bowels of mercy. And there is this idea, this thought in the ancient world that whatever you were feeling was tied to your bowels. And we would recognize it in the phrases that we have now, right? Gut-wrenching. But when we see something, we would say that it's gut-wrenching. We feel it, but we also feel it in our bowels, right? Or if you've ever been nervous, you feel like you have a pit in your stomach, right? There's this language that is tied immediately to how you feel. So we are to have, right, this compassionate mercy, or like the King James would say, right, what the Lord has for us is this bowels of mercy. And since it's been shown to us, there is something that we should be coming, right, that we should have coming out of us, right? It is not our first instinct when someone comes to us in need, right? Sometimes we're often annoyed. Sometimes we're just bothered by even that one person coming up with another problem that they have. We don't have this bowel of mercy, right? Our heart, our stomachs aren't turned towards them. But we read here what Christ has done for us, right? We were in no way, shape, or form deserving of any kind of mercy, and yet it is something that has been bestowed upon us, right? If we continue through Romans, we will see it time and time again. How great you deserve nothing. You deserve hell. You deserve eternal exile from God. And yet, He has called you. He has chosen you. And He bestows mercy on you. And in turn, the teachings are that we outwardly do these things for other people. See, God shows His love for us. So much love that while we were still sinners, He died for us. Like, that should put in us, right? That should move our bowels. That's the last time I'm going to say that, right? It should do something in us, right? Because we are recipients of this great mercy, it should make something come out of us. It should do something to us. We don't get to come to Christ and say, that's it. We come to Christ and we're different. Right. We come to Christ and we don't look like the old self. We don't look like we have anger, malice. But we look like we have compassionate mercy. We look like we have patience and kindness and meekness. So as Paul would kind of continue to write that we are heirs, fellow heirs with Christ, provided that we suffer with them in order that we might be glorified with Him. So that should be that driving force. When we look at the life of Christ and all that He's done for us, that should put in us that want, that desire to take off the old self and put on the new. So how do we get there? We focus. We meditate on the life of Christ. We set our minds on what has been done for us. We should look at the undeserving mess that we are and turn around and go, I need to be like Christ. I need to put on these things, because it is, brothers and sisters, a command that we put off the old self and put on the new. So what does that mean? Right? Christ says, if you love me, you keep my commandments. So we don't get to pick and choose. Again, brothers and sisters, we don't get to pick and choose when we're Christians. We don't get to pick and choose what part of the old self that we want to hold on to. We have to let those things go. And so as we consider these things, and as we go over these things, that should be the fuel that lights the fire underneath you. That should be your driving force. And so, when we think in light of everything that we've read, right? Can you imagine? Just can you imagine this? If this was us, if this was our prayer, Lord, that you would be pleased to bring someone who talks badly about me. That you would bring a very difficult person into my life to deal with me. And Lord, that you would see these virtues in me. That you would see me be compassionate. That you would see me be kind. That you would see me show meekness and kindness towards these people that are against me. See, we need objects of expression, right? Because we don't pray like that. We don't say, Lord, raise somebody up to make false accusations against me. We don't say, Lord, raise up an individual who is just bent on making my life terrible. We don't pray for someone who just seeks to invent things to frustrate us. Instead, we pray that, Lord, you make me humble, expecting to wake up the next morning humble. Lord, give me, right, that you would give me patience and expect to wake up the next morning a patient person. We ask all of these things, and our focus is never on Christ. Our focus is always on this person who is just hard to be compassionate with. If we're honest with ourselves, we are so focused on this person who just drives me insane. This person who just we are so certain is here just to make my life miserable. Sorry. I'm not used to this. But instead, our hearts and our minds, again, if Christ is all and in all, that is where our mind should be. Because when it's solely focused on the individual that is causing you problems, we will begin to only display contempt. But when we put our mind on Christ, we will be reminded and we will be renewed that God took us from where we were and put us on solid ground. See, all that we do, we should look at how God took someone like us, like me, showed me mercy, showed me compassion. And to be honest, right, in our sinful heart, we didn't want. We didn't want to be rescued. We would much rather be in our filth. We would much rather be able to act angry and show malice towards people. But when we look at the forgiveness that has been placed on us, that should drive us to look at those who are around us and put in us a fire to forgive them. So as we read through the Gospels, we see that the Lord Jesus would look on crowds and it says that he would have compassion on them. Meaning that it didn't matter who they were, but he was going to have compassion on them. And then we look at our lives, right? Just that one person that I see every day. Am I willing to have compassion on this person? Or do I immediately get annoyed? You see, God doesn't show, right? Not favoritism, that's not the word. But God, when he looks at you with compassion. How are we going, now that we know this, going to react to the person that cuts you off? Are we going to have compassion on him or are we going to show pity? Because that is us, right? That person that cut you off, that person that really grinds your gears, if we're honest, are the things that we don't like about ourselves. And so they bother us that much more. So moving forward, we need to look to Christ, to put our mind on Christ and the things that he has done for us. See, the language that Paul uses here is the exact same language that Jesus uses. You know, that we need to forgive others. And then Jesus says, right, forgive those who trespass against us. It's like, it's this balance that we need to have. All of this, in seriousness, brothers and sisters, is a command. We don't get to be pick and choose the type of Christian we want to be. It's laid out for us. And I love that Paul gives us no wiggle room. He says, this is it. Whether you like it or not. And there are these things that you don't do anymore because of the work that has been done for you and through you. Brothers and sisters, my challenge to you this morning is that you would set your mind on Christ, that you would set your desires to be like him, that you would allow who you used to be, what you've been saved from, what you've been brought out of, that fuel you to show compassion and kindness and patience to those around you. So that being said, I've never been a good closer, but that's all I have for you this morning. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much for giving me the privilege. I don't want to come up here and act like I exemplify everything having to do with verse 12. I very much, brothers and sisters, struggle like you every day to show compassion, patience, kindness. And it's not just the people around me, it's my wife sometimes, it's my kids. And so if we call ourselves Christians, if we would claim Christ and say that he is all and in all, then brothers and sisters, let our actions prove that. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Joshua. Amen. Thank you. Let's pray, and I just want to let y'all know that the Lord is, you know, one of the things that we need to find out, right? God calls us all, right, to be, you know, to be saved. But after that, after you've been called to be saved and you receive it and you put your trust in him and he has chosen you, there's another calling in your life. Right, you know, another calling of being a preacher, pastor, minister, and evangelist, and music director, and all these things, you know, and God is calling y'all to do these things. You know, you never know what can happen, right? I'm here one day, the next day might not be here, not because of my own choosing, but because where God leads me, God directs me. And so that we need to be ready for that calling, right? I know I'm ready. If God calls me to somewhere else, I'm going to go. You know. But I know that he has me here right now. But I just want to make sure that y'all understand that God is calling y'all. Don't ever think, you know, God transforms you. God has called you amongst the people. He's made you a peculiar nation, you are his people, and he has commissioned us. He has not given us the option, but he has commissioned us to go and preach the gospel. So with that being said, we're going to end with this song. I'm not a singer, but I'm going to pray, and we're going to end.
Thank you.
good, I'm not worshiping, doing it for her.